XJRunner integration gives you the ability to use boundary scan testing within LabVIEW. It allows your own VIs to call tests or programming routines that were created from within XJ Developer ready for XJRunner to use. In this short video, I'll demonstrate how to integrate those boundary scan tests into LabVIEW. You might also like to know that this series contains equivalent videos for test stand users and for engineers working with a .NET framework. I'll be demonstrating the different points by using one of the example VIs that come with the default XJTAG installation. They're included so you can use them in your own code, so feel free to import them. You'll find them in the XJIntegration.net examples folder, which is in the XJTAG directory that's in your public documents folder. Bear in mind, if you do use them, that you can't just copy and paste individual VIs into your project. Instead, you'll either need to copy the complete examples directory with its full set of VIs, or reference each one in its original installed location. The example I'm going to look at is the one called Single Test Run. If you want to follow along, you'll need to load the LabVIEW project XJRunner integration, and then open the VI from there. So let's look at what it does. The steps you need to perform before you can run a test were summarised in the opening video of this series. The first thing done in this example is to initialise an XJ link to establish communication. That's performed within this VI here, called XJTAG init XJ link. If I open it, you can see it uses getXJLink to initialise a JTAG controller. You can either pass in a specific controller's serial number as an unsigned integer, or pass in nothing and let the software use the first controller it finds that's not in use. Having initialised the XJLink, it proceeds to open a project and run the tests it contains. This VI, called XJTAGRunProj, performs both of those steps. If I expand it, you can see that XJTAGLoadProj opens the project, and XJTAGRun then runs the tests. Let's look first at XJTAGLoadProj. It starts by creating a runnerProject object, and then uses the getTestList method on that runnerProject to generate a list of available tests. I'll explain about test lists in a moment, but for now, let's look at loading the project and, in particular, what file to use. You could use XJ Developer's XJD project file if you've got an XJ Developer license, but that's normally only useful during project development. After the design has been released for first production, I would recommend you work with an XJPack file instead. That's the file exported from XJ Developer. Using it means you'll be working with something that isn't going to change unexpectedly if someone updates the project without realising you're using it. Having loaded the project, you then need to get its test list. So let's think about that. The thing to understand about the test list is that when the tests were created in XJ Developer and added to the list, they were also given default settings that determine whether they run by default or not. When you use the tests via XJRunner integration, you have choices. You can run the test list as it stands with those default settings, or you can override those settings so that it will run either all the tests, a different set, or just one individual test. Let me show you how to use those different options. If you return to XJTAGRunProj, you can see this VI that's called XJTAGSelectTests. It takes the test list, allows the default settings to be changed, and then passes the list with the new settings to the VI that's going to run them. You can either use this switch to tell it to perform all the default tests, or you can provide an array of strings containing the names of specific tests you want to run. The adjusted test collection is then passed into XJTAGRun, and your selected tests are executed. One thing to be careful about if you run just one test from the list in isolation is that tests might have conditions attached that can prevent them executing. These conditions would have been set in XJ Developer when the test list was created. They're indicated in XJRunner and XJ Developer by this question mark. The circumstances under which a particular test or group of tests will run can be made dependent on another test having passed. For example, you wouldn't want to do a time-consuming programming task if previous tests on the board had failed. When XJRunner integration performs a test, any attached conditions will be obeyed by default, so running such a test by itself may not work. In which case, either ensure you run all related tests together or use the method of the condition class called override to disable the condition. Once all your tests have been run on a board, it's time to dispose the runner instance. In the first video of this series, I summarised the importance of disposing objects at the correct times, and now's a good moment to show you how to do that in practice. When you've totally finished using a board, you need to dispose the old runner instance so that the project's global variables get reset. In LabVIEW, that's done with dispose.net.vi. You can see this whole process if you open XJTAG run. First, it creates an object of the runner class by calling getRunner on the runner project object, and then runs the tests from the test list. But what's important to note is that when all the testing is complete on that board, the runner's refnum is passed into the dispose.net VI, which disposes the runner for you. That same VI will dispose any .NET object passed into it, so you can also use it to dispose the project and the XJLink instances once you've finished with those as well. Right at the end, once all testing with the equipment is completed, you should then perform a system close. That does a final cleanup to ensure all the threads that XJTAG created are stopped. In the example we've been looking at, that's done by the VI called XJTAG close. Back in the top level block diagram, XJTAG close comes here, right at the end. If I open it, you can see that it ensures no objects have been left open, and then uses the xjtagsystem.close method for the final cleanup. I hope you found this a useful introduction to using XJ integration in LabVIEW. There are still two other things worth explaining though, and I'll be covering those in the next video. One's the difference between running a test and starting a test, and the other is the ability to call functions as well as tests. Thank you for watching this video. If you found it helpful, please subscribe for more and leave a like or a comment below.